And I don't know about you. I love New Year's. I love, you know, to make new goals. I am a morning person. Anybody else a morning person? No? Yeah. I feel like maybe there's a correlation between morning people loving New Year's more than anybody else. But I don't know about you. I love New Year's and making new goals and new strides in my life. And I'm so excited that we're starting a new conversation today, a new sermon series today called Becoming Fully Alive, where we're going to be talking about this topic of emotional health, getting healthy internally so that we can be healthy externally. And maybe that's a new idea for you, or maybe it's something you've been doing in your own life, but that's going to be what we're talking about today. If you're new with us, welcome. We're so glad that you are here today. And all that we ask you to do is that on your way in, you got a bulletin, and in there is something called a connect card. If you just want to fill out as much as possible, as much as you want to share with us, and then rip it off. And later in the service, there's going to be some giving bags that go down your row. We're going to take up an offering. We don't want you to give. What we'd ask instead is that you just put that connect card right in there. That'll be happening later in the service. But you can start right now by filling out that connect card, just letting us know how we can connect with you. And how we can better connect with you. But right here in this moment, we're going to be starting a new year together by singing together, by singing songs about God, singing songs to God, declaring things together. And we really believe something here at this church is that when we come together and we sing to God, that there's something amazing that can happen in community when we do this together. You're here for a reason. The reason, I don't know why, but you decided to step out of the anonymity of your own home and come to a gathering of people and sing together. And that's no small deal. That's a huge deal. And so whether you're a regular or whether this is your first time and you're stepping out in faith, kind of just like, I'm going to figure this out. I'm going to see what this is all about, starting a new year that way. We're so glad you're here. And it's going to be an awesome, awesome day. We're really excited to start this new conversation today. So in just a moment, myself, Adriana, Mariana, we're going to lead you in some songs as we sing to God. But would you just take a moment right now, stand up, give somebody a fist pump and say Happy New Year. High five.
Thank you.
we continue singing this morning, we want to declare things that we just sang about, that the enemy would have no place in our lives. As we mark a new year, I don't know what is holding you back today. I don't know what internally is happening in you or what's happening in your family or in your work situation, but I know that God wants to do something new, that he doesn't want to just repeat the past for you. He wants to do something brand new. And for some of us, we've been clinging to the things that God's saying, that's passed away. That is old. I'm doing something new today. And so today might be a new beginning for you, a place to just say, you know, I'm starting off on a different foot today. I'm going to declare your victory in my life. So let's continue singing together. My sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope and no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. And my orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. Let's sing this out. Oh, your grace.
Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. Yeah. My shame was a ransom you faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, oh, your grace, so washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. 'Cause it's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us. Savior displayed on a criminal's cross, and darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. Yeah. That's when death was arrested in my washes over me.
Good morning. You may be seated. Welcome to Faith Church. We are glad that you're starting out the new year 2019 with us here at Faith Church. And if you're new here, we're super glad that you're giving us a shot. I hope that you feel at home. When you got here, you received a brochure and that bulletin. And in that bulletin, there's a Connect card. We'd love for you to, if possible, fill that Connect card in and give it to us. We're going to take our morning offering in just a moment. So when we take our morning offering, rather than giving, if you're new here, we'd like for you to fill that Connect card and maybe fill out as much as possible and drop it in the giving bag. Or even better, a great way to do this is to do it online, faithauburn.info. There's a digital Connect card that you can fill out and make sure you submit it. It's just a great way for us to connect with you as we start the new year. We're really excited about new people being here. So, yeah, we're going to take our morning offering, and I just want to tell you a little bit about the great opportunity that we have as a new year, and what a great opportunity for us to start giving. If you have been here a while, we have an opportunity to give back to God, and you're when you give towards our mission to love and lead people into a growing faith in Jesus. And we do this by caring for our community, by supporting missionaries overseas, and also making sure that we caring for the next generations as well. When you give, you give towards the next generation to learn how to love God. And we're glad to be a part of that. You're giving to lives change. I got two announcements for you guys, and I'll be quick. Number one, starting point is January 20th. And this is a great small group that meets for 8 weeks. And what happens here is that if you have questions about faith, if you have questions, maybe you haven't been at church for a while and you just kind of need a fresh start, and you're wondering about some questions, you weren't wondering about your faith, you're tired of your faith being theoretical and you want it to become real, this is a great place for you to learn and maybe get some of your questions answered. So if you're new here, or if you're new to faith, if you haven't been to church in a while, whatever, just go to faithauburn.info and sign up for Starting Point starting at January 20th. You won't regret it. I think you're going to get it along with the people that are teaching it, and you're going to be able to get some of your answers questions. More than one person has the same question that you have. And number two, we don't have a slide for this, but as you guys may know, we do missionary trips once in a while, and last year we did one to Puerto Rico. Well, we're going to Puerto Rico again because we're excited about the relationships that we've established with them. So we're going to Puerto Rico July 20th to the 27th, 2019, and we have an informational meeting happening next week and then 2 weeks from then. Next week we have an informational meeting. If you're just interested in finding out some details about Puerto Rico, we'll love for you to check it out next week after the 11 o'clock service. So right after this, we'll be meeting at the lobby. We're going to take our morning offering and let's give joyfully. Again, once again, if you're new here, just drop that Connect card. Even better, today we have a welcome reception. So after the service, you can go across those doors, past the lobby, the main lobby, and go to the room that has a sign that says welcome. We'd love to connect with you. One of our pastors is going to be there to greet you, and we'd love to hang out with you for a bit. Anyways, I am super glad because we're continuing this series called Becoming Fully Alive. And I don't know about you guys, but there are areas of my life that can sincerely use some of that in our lives. Sometimes I just started reading this book called Finish by John Acuff, and one of the things that he was talking about is how we're so quick about kind of ending our New Year's resolution if we don't have a streak going. Well, we have an opportunity to take a look at this series that's going to teach us about how to go beyond, you know, perfection, but rather looking at things in our lives that will really help us make strides in the things that we want to become. And I don't know about you guys, but I know that God is not done with me yet. I'm not where I want to be. God has better things in my life, and I think you can relate to that. I believe that with all my heart for you guys. Without further ado, let's take a look at this video and continue to worship.
This is Skylar from Hope for Haiti. During the month of January, we'll be partnering with Reach by Cosley and all of you to provide education to children in Haiti. Every 10 check-ins this month will help provide one day of education for a classroom of 30 children. For the last 30 years, Hope for Haiti has been working to alleviate poverty in Haiti through our core programs: education, healthcare, infrastructure, water, and economic opportunity. We believe that education is a basic human right, and that's the work that you're going to be helping support through your check-ins. Don't forget to check in this month. You're doing a great service to Hope for Haiti. Thank you so much.
How fickle my heart and how woozy my eyes. I struggle to find any truth in your lies. And now my heart stumbles on things I don't know. My weakness I feel I must finally show. Lend me your hand and we'll conquer them all. Lend me your heart and I'll just let you fall. Lend me your eyes and can change what you see. But your soul you must keep totally free. Heart, 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 heart. Bodies we will live, in these bodies we will die, and where you invest your love, you invest your life.
Well, good morning, everyone. I am just so excited about this series that we're doing right now. I love, love, love the idea of it ever since we stole it. We went to a conference back in October, and our staff was there, and this was the series, and we just absolutely loved it. It was great for us, and we knew this was going to be great for our congregation, too. Let me tell you a story of a good friend of mine. When back in college, he was planning, he's a pastor now, back in college, he was planning for a career in medicine. So he became a medical assistant, an intern while he was in college, and he was working in a private nursing facility. And one night he had just one simple task, to sit by the bedside of an ailing man. Clearly he was kind of in the last throes of his life, and my friend was just to sit there and take his vitals every hour on the hour, you know, just chart it out, blood pressure, heart rate, etc., every hour on the hour. At least, that's what he was supposed to do. And anyhow, you know, the night went on, and the next morning, the attending physician came in, took a look at the chart, took a look at the patient, another look at the chart, another look at the patient, the chart, the patient, the chart, the patient, picked up the man's heels, and the man was stiff from rigor mortis. He had clearly been dead for several hours. When asked my friend, well, why does the chart say that you've been checking him? You just checked him 20 minutes ago. He said, well, he was resting so comfortably, I didn't want to wake him. That's why my friend's a pastor now and not a medical doctor. Some of us this morning are resting so comfortably, aren't we? And this sermon series is kind of like a spiritual CPR for us. To make us fully alive, not just a little bit alive, fully alive. Our theme verse, we have one theme verse for this entire series, the next 4 weeks. I bet you some of you can guess. John 10:10. Jesus says this, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. The thief, the imposter, the shadow person comes. Not to give, but to take. We don't know his identity, but we know what he wants to do. He wants something from the sheep, not for the sheep. But Jesus contrasts that emphatically by saying this, I have come that they might have life. And have it to the full. Abundant life. Full life. And you know what's the best part of this? You know, we could say, you know, okay, eternal life. Hey, great. Someday then, in the sweet by and by, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Great life to come in the clouds, wherever. But the reality is that this is present tense, folks. Jesus is saying this for the here and the now. It's as if he's saying, oh, no, eternal life. It begins now. I want to give you abundant life now. Not just someday, but now. I don't know if that's good news for you, but it's really good news for me. Because I know that there are days in my life when my tanks are running dry. We just came through the Christmas season, right? Anybody's tanks running a little empty? Little empty, just a little empty from Christmas. Emotionally, we're just, we're tired, we're exhausted. And here's the good news. What I fully believe that this verse means, Jesus means that he's come not just to give us spiritual abundance, but everything. In other words, I am not just a spiritual person. I'm an emotional, I'm a mental case sometimes. Yes, I am. I'm intellectual, I'm physical, and all of these things combined, Jesus says, I want to provide health. You know, we're integrated, we're holistic. I don't think that you could be spiritually healthy and emotionally unhealthy. You know, I can't come to you and, you know, be frustrated at you and tell you off and get exasperated at you and think that I'm okay spiritually. Doesn't happen that way. And so really, truly, we're going to, through the next 4 weeks, we're going to look at this really wonderful area of health that Jesus wants to bring us into. And I don't know, for some of you this morning, you are either going to love this series or you're going to loathe this series. Now, for some of you walking in, maybe you've come as a result of Christmas Eve services. Maybe you're kind of new to all this stuff. You're in a church you're not really sure too much about. And I just want to welcome you. We're not all strange, let me tell you that. Some of us, but we're not all strange. And this is good news, I think, for everybody here. I think we can hopefully agree on that. That this is the kind of thing that is, often we don't talk about it, but it's good for us to hear, isn't it? That there is somebody in heaven on our side who wants to help and heal. So we're going to talk about something today that, again, is going to be one of those maybe harder topics to talk about. And I want to start with a quote. We'll play 20 question. Actually not. You'll never get it. Who said this? Without knowledge of self, there is no knowledge of God. Without self, there is no knowledge of God. Somebody in our first service guessed Tom Brady. No, Tom Brady did not say this. Okay? Maybe someone might say Oprah. Oprah said it. You know, that could be. Maybe Joel Osteen said it. Maybe. No, you're wrong. No, it wasn't him. Maybe you go back a little bit further. Maybe some like Norman Vincent Peale, the power of positive thinking guy, you know. Or even further back, Ralph Waldo Emerson, who's the father of transcendentalism. You know, that guy's into transcendental meditation, that kind of stuff. Nope, he's not either. You have to go back 500 years to a man by the name of John Calvin in 1536. Now, you're going to say, who on earth is John Calvin? Okay. John Calvin was right there, kind of alongside of Martin Luther, right back during the days of the Protestant Reformation over 500 years ago. John Calvin is known for these lofty theological ideas on the sovereignty of God. I have to say that with a really low, deep voice. The sovereignty of God and predestination and election. And yet, he opens his theological treatise called The Institutes of the Christian Religion with this statement. He opens his two-volume treatise, this heavy, deep thing, with, without a knowledge of self, there is no knowledge of God. I don't know about you. I find that a little surprising. Here's a guy so immersed in theology, and yet he recognizes that there is a deep and fundamental thing going on in us that we're not going to know God best unless we know ourselves better. That the two have to go hand in hand. We're talking about self-awareness today. Now, I said this is a hard topic. This isn't something that a lot of us like to think about. In fact, in the last 100, 200 years in the Christian church, 20th century, 21st century, there's not been a lot of people in the church writing about this. Do you know who has been writing about it? The business community. You guessed it. A man by the name of Dan Goleman, back in 1995, wrote a book entitled Emotional Intelligence. And he said, in no uncertain terms, he said, in the business world, emotional intelligence is as important or more important than intellectual intelligence. In other words, it's better to walk into a room and to decipher the temperature of the room and the people that are in the room and yourself with it more than what's just going on upstairs. I think he's onto something. And I just wish the church would start talking more about this, because this is entirely, absolutely critical. The greatest impediment that you and I are going to have in our spiritual lives, growing in our ability to follow Jesus, is right here, this morning. Spiritual awareness. So I might ask you the question this morning. Here's the question. How well do you know yourself? I mean, truly, truly, truly know yourself. How true is your view of you? Do you really have a good sense of everything that's going down, way down deep inside? What did you do on your Christmas vacation? I'll tell you what I did on my Christmas vacation. I took the week off and we cleaned our basement. Woo! It was a really fun time, but it needed it. Oy, there was stuff down there that I had not seen in decades. I didn't know what was really down in our basement. I found an old drum kit. There was a bass amp. There was one of those ZZ Top electric guitars. There was an acoustic guitar. There was speaker system down there. You name it. You notice a theme going on here, right? All my kids left all their instruments in the basement. And I don't go on Facebook very often, but I'm on Facebook Marketplace right now, and I'm selling off everything. And I'm taking it all for myself. That's right. What's in your basement? What's way down deep inside? Or what's up in the attic or the garage or wherever you store your stuff? What dirt is there? You haven't cleaned out in a long time, have you? And it's time that we really owned up to some of those things going on. And we're going to look at a scripture verse today. And I really struggled over who to use in the scriptures who struggled with self-awareness. You know why I struggled? Because there's so many of them in the Bible, people who struggled with self-awareness. But the one I came up with was, best of all, I think, is the Apostle Peter. We're going to look at the Apostle Peter this morning and Jesus predicting Peter's denial in Mark chapter 14. Now, what's interesting about the gospel according to Mark, there are four biographical accounts of Jesus: Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Mark is the shortest of them. What's interesting about Mark's gospel is this. John Mark was a disciple of a disciple. He was really the disciple of like this guy by the name of Barnabas that we find later on in the book of Acts. But for eyewitness account purposes, his source of information about Jesus, guess who it was? The Apostle Peter. Peter was probably the eyewitness account filling in all the details so that Mark could just kind of write down. So this isn't probably the Gospel of Mark as much as it is the Gospel of Peter. And you know how Peter presents himself in this Gospel? The stumbling, bumbling, bombastic disciple that he really is. I mean, if you look at who Peter is and how he comes across in the Gospel of Mark, he doesn't come across too well. He comes across with saying some pretty stupid stuff in the Gospel account. And here's one of those accounts where Peter is just going to come across looking really dumb, really dumb. And so let's get into the story here. Mark chapter 14. When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. So this is the Last Supper. We're going to experience communion in a moment, and that's where the Last Supper took place. This is literally hours before the crucifixion. And Jesus goes off to the Mount of Olives, which is the place where Jesus often went for prayer. It's called the Garden of Gethsemane. In the section right after this, he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane for prayer. And you know why? Because he needs strength. And his only source of strength is going to be prayer to his Father. I think it's a good lesson for us all, isn't it? You know, when we are just strung out, that is the place where we should go, because he's not going to have anyone else supporting him through this. And he more or less says so in this next section, this next verse. And Jesus said to them, "You will all fall away because it is written, I will strike down the shepherd and the sheep shall be scattered." There's three very sobering facts that are going to happen within the next few minutes, the next few hours. First of all of the disciples, not one will be left standing beside Jesus. Imagine that. In the hour of your need, no one is there. And that's where Jesus is going to be. All of them will fall away. Not one will stand with him in that great moment of tribulation. And they will fall away. And the word here is an interesting word. In the Greek, it's the word scandalizo. It's the word from where we get the word scandal from. They are going to fall away because they are scandalized by Jesus, offended by Jesus. It means to trip over or stumble over. In other words, their idea of what the Messiah should be, the triumphant king riding in on a majestic white horse, reigning over Rome, you know, slugging, duking it out with Rome, kicking those pagans to the curb, that's all gone by the wayside, and they get scandalized by the cross. Their own selfish ambitions, their own desires, you know, they want to ride the coattails of Jesus on into the power of the kingdom and be the king, and they want to be his, you know, his right and left on his right and left, and be the, you know, the governors of the land, and all that's gone by the wayside, and they're scandalized by the cross. You know what Paul the apostle said to the Philippians? He said, "I want to know Christ, the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings." Who wants to know the fellowship of sharing in Jesus' sufferings? Not many of us, do we? And that's what they were scandalized by. They had to put their own ambitions aside, and that's not what they were comfortable in doing. And so they fell away. They were scandalized by the cross. And thirdly, they scattered, just like sheep do when they lose their shepherd. Sheep are a very anxious bunch, and they were scattered. You know, turn the light on, and what do cockroaches do? They scatter. And that's what these disciples, like little cockroaches, they just scattered everywhere. They just were flung into this chaotic fit, and they just, they're gone. It's like the movement has evaporated in a heartbeat. But it's not over. Jesus gives now a little bit of a hint of hope, a little bright spot on the horizon, an affirmation, because this is what he's going to say now, but after I've risen. Do you know anybody that can predict their death and resurrection? Only Jesus does. You thought death was final, and Jesus says, nope, not for me. After I will rise again, after I come back from the dead, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. You know what he's saying here? He's saying two things. First of all, my death is not final. Second of all, your failure is not final. It's not over with me, and it's not over with you. I'm coming back, and you will be with me again. You will return. Even though you fall away, even though you walk away, even though you scatter, you're still going to be my disciples. I'm coming back for you. That's good news for us, isn't it? That's really good news. Now here comes Peter. Peter is hearing all this. And everything's boiling up inside of him. He's like, no, not me. So he just can't contain himself any longer. And now he blurts out, verse 29, Peter declares, "Even if all fall away, I will not." You know what they're made of, Jesus, but not me. Can you imagine talking back to God? That's what Peter's doing here. Jesus, you don't know me the way I know me. I got this. I can handle it. I'm going all the way with you, Jesus. And what does Jesus have to say? I got some really bad news for you, Peter. Really bad news. In fact, this whole statement now from Jesus is going to, he's going to kind of like mount up fact after fact after fact. It's going to get worse and worse in his assessment of how it's going to go for Peter. "Truly I tell you," Jesus answered, "today," yes, tonight, "before the rooster crows twice, you yourself will disown me three times." You're not going to just fall away, Peter. You're going to completely deny me. You're going to deny ever knowing me. You're going to turn away in such a way that you are going to, with your mouth, Peter, you're going to deny me not once, not twice, three times that you even know me. And again, Peter's swagger and his bravado take over, and he emphatically insists. The word there just means, like, he's almost yelling at Jesus right now, emphatically insisting. Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. You know, there's two negatives here, so it really should read, I will never, never disown you. So how well do you think Peter knows Peter? Not too much, does he? He is so self-deluded, and he also helps others to delude themselves as well. And all the others said the same. His bravado is contagious, it's infectious, and he causes all the rest to say the same. Now, some of you know the rest of the story about Peter, don't you? In a few short hours, Peter's going to be standing there by a fire. Jesus has been taken off by the soldiers. Jesus is going to be standing there by a fire warming himself. And a little slave girl, I don't know, 9, 10, 11, 12 years old. Excuse me, sir. Weren't you with Jesus? I never knew the man. One. Excuse me, sir. I am sure that I saw you with Jesus. I told you, you runt, I never knew the man. Just one more time. I am sure I saw you with Jesus. I never knew the blankety blank man. He literally swears. Do you notice something surprising? That Peter denies his Lord with the same intensity that he affirms his Lord. His negation is as strong as his affirmation. He is so deluded, isn't he? Here's the problem with us all, isn't it? And let me tell you, I witnessed this too many times. The problem is this: the more perfectly arrived you think you are, the more positively depraved you are. If you think you've arrived, if you think that you're spiritual this morning, then you're not. If you think you've gotten to a large degree and you're down the road and you're better than everybody else, spiritually speaking, guess what? You're the furthest from God. One of the things Jesus talks about in another gospel, Matthew's gospel, chapter 5, he talks about the spiritual life. It's called the Sermon on the Mount. And you know how he begins the Sermon on the Mount? That the very first characteristic of a disciple, blessed are those who are poor in spirit, bankrupt before God. In other words, only if you know you haven't arrived are you in a good place. Only if you know that you've still got such a ton of work to do going forward, spiritually speaking, to become a devoted follower in Jesus, only then are you really in a good place before God. It's just owning up to the baggage. It's owning up to the dirt inside. Ann Landers, the columnist, once put it this way: don't accept your dog's admiration of you as conclusive evidence that you're a wonderful person. So true. The easiest person we can deceive is ourselves. And it's so easy to delude, so easy to be clouded over in our judgment of ourselves. And the biggest impediment to spiritual growth is just not seeing ourselves for how Jesus sees us. So what does that look like? Let me just give you a couple examples. All right, just really quick examples. And I'm going to start with one that's just so obvious, and we'll move into the more relevant areas that may be a little harder for us to see because they're so personal. Back during the days of World War II, there was a man who worked with Adolf Hitler. Let's show this slide. So you'll notice Adolf Hitler there in the middle. To Adolf Hitler's right, this man over here, his name is Albert Speer. Albert Speer was the architect of the Nazi regime, the Third Reich. He was the master of the whole war machine. It was really because of him that Germany did so well in the war. I mean, he had, you know what he did? He took Henry Ford's ideas of the assembly line and he put it to work for Germany. He was so ambitious and so intelligent, an intelligent man, a wonderful bureaucrat, a good family man, and all-around great guy, may I say. At least that's how his friends saw it. When he came and appeared before the Nuremberg trial, and that was where they tried all of the Nazi, you know, war people and tried them. When asked, did you know anything about Auschwitz and the death camps? No, I didn't know anything. Oh, I was completely unaware of what was going on to the Jews. I'm heartbroken over it. Truly heartbroken. I didn't know anything like that was going on. And he was the only one let off. Well, let off with 20 years in prison. The others were put to death. But in his memoirs and in all of those who interviewed him, it was learned that he absolutely did know everything going on about the final solution, the death of six and a half million. And he's been used as kind of an illustration through the ages of someone who can so easily tell themselves stories to protect themselves from the truth of who they really are. Like, I really can't be that monster. I certainly can't be that evil person that everybody thinks I am. And so you start to compartmentalize. You start to seclude. And it's so easy to seclude and delude yourself, deceive yourself. Some of us might wonder, so what were the Christians doing, the German Christians doing during the days of World War II? You know what one person said on Sunday morning when they'd have their church services and they'd hear the trains go by of the Jews, the cries from the death trains as they went out to Auschwitz, it would come very near to their church buildings. One person said, you know what we'd do? We'd sing louder. Self-deception. We delude ourselves. We try to tell ourselves a story that's really not true. All right. Well, that's 75 years ago. What about now? Maybe it's the husband who sits in front of his computer screen late at night. And he tries to tell himself the images that I'm looking at on the screen have nothing to do with the slave trade going on around the world, the sex slave trade. Maybe it has nothing to do with how poorly my marriage is going right now. And, you know, it's not hurting anybody. That's the story that he tries to tell himself. That's the delusion that he stays within to keep himself doing what just he can't stop doing. Or maybe it's a wife that says, you know, I need some me time. I need some me time, and I'm going to go off to the gym. And the housewife, the mom, the wife, really likes how she is looking in the mirror. And you know what she's liking more? The leering eyes, the adulation of other men who are giving her some attention now. And before you know it, she's starting to walk down this road, a very bad road of getting further and further away from who she ever thought she could be, but she's liking the attention from other men. Or maybe it's the businessman, the businesswoman who's coming home. You put the kids to bed and you're just tired and exhausted and you just decide, I just need to get some relief. And so you pour yourself a glass of wine and you pour yourself another glass of wine. And another, because you deserve it. It's been a long, hard week, and suddenly three become four, and four become five, and suddenly it's a binge, and it's happening over and over and over again. Do you know that for women between the ages of 35 and 55, binge drinking has increased 60% in the last 10 years. Increased 60% binge drinking. See, what does AA say? You're as sick as your secrets. What you don't see, what you refuse to see, what you don't know, you can't fix. Self-awareness, understanding really the problems that are way down inside. Jesus knows it, and he doesn't want to reveal it to us in order that, you know, to beat us up. He wants to help us. He wants to heal us. He wants to give us the abundant life. So what do? Let's get off this picture, all right? We've been on it way too long. Dealing with your dirt develops your depth. Develops your depth as a husband, a father, a follower of Jesus. The more that you become aware of the stuff in the basement, the better off you're going to be. And this is going to be healthy for you going forward as a person in Christ, the person God wants you to be, dealing with your dirt. You know, and that is the understanding of Scripture over and over again. You know what David, King David, way back in the Old Testament, the psalmist, he wrote this, "Search me, O God. Search me. Know my heart." He's inviting God to scan him. "Come on, Lord. Come and just show up and tell me who I am. See if there is any offensive way in me. If there's any dirt, any ugliness, and lead me in the way everlasting." This path of eternal life, God, you got to get me on it. You got to show me what's wrong. Lead me into what's right. This is a healthy, healthy prayer to make. Search me, O God. You know, when you look at the big skyscrapers in New York or Boston or Chicago, do you know how they stand without falling over? They drive those massive, massive pylons way down into the dirt, unseen by the human eye. In other words, what's under the dirt, what's down in the earth, is more important than what's above the earth. Do you know that the skyscrapers in Boston, John Hancock, Prudential, those pylons are driven down 25 stories down into the bedrock? See, that's what we're talking about here. We're talking about drilling deep and getting to the bedrock, the solid rock of Jesus, and resting on that. So what does it look like? Let's talk about this process because it's not an easy one. This is not just something that goes simply for you. It's not something that will take you, you know, a few hours to do. This is a lifetime. It starts with awareness. First of all, you become aware of your emotions and what's going on. Am I tired? Am I frustrated? Am I anxious? Am I angry? It's getting in touch with your feelings. Oh, you guys, you men out there, you just love to do that, don't you, right? But it's being aware and then finally understanding it. It's saying, okay, I'm frustrated. And here's the story. Here's the why. This is why I'm frustrated. I know the story that got me here, and hopefully, through the power of Jesus, I can rewrite the story. And then it's being able to communicate it, understanding, and then communication. Maybe it's journaling. Maybe it's just sitting with a friend, an accountability partner, and beginning to tell them what's going on. Because if you can't communicate it, then you don't understand it. So this is an important step. And then dealing honestly with yourself. You know, it's not beating up only on yourself, but it's recognizing your strengths, your abilities, but also your shortcomings. It's looking at your whole self and saying, well, this is who I am, and dealing honestly with that, and then finally realizing that you have impact. When you walk into the room, you change the temperature. Do you want to change it for good or for bad? So it's going through this healthy, healthy, healthy process with the Lord, letting Jesus take control. So how about search me, O God? Why not let this prayer make it your prayer to be self-aware in the new year? See how that rhymes? You like that? You know, we come to this table today. You know, it's so important to talk about these things as we come to communion, as we come and commune with the living God. There's a little book that I remember seeing when I first became a Christian. My Heart, Christ's Home. Way, way long time ago. And the story was kind of like this. Jesus is knocking on our door, and he wants to come inside the house. And he just doesn't want to stand out on the doorstep, does he? He wants to see every nook and crevice. He wants to see what's down in the basement. He wants to see what's in that hallway closet. Ooh. Wants to look at the kitchen, you know, because that's where the family meets. Wants to spend some time there. Wants to go into the living room, turn on the TV, see what you've been watching on Netflix and Hulu. Why? Because he wants to beat you up? No. Wants to make you healthy. Might want to go inside your bedroom. Yeah, that place where our marriages are celebrated. He wants to go there too. He wants all of it, not just a part of it. And he's the one that can bring abundance and healing to our lives. Would you let him in? Come to this table today, letting Jesus in. And I know that sounds like a scary thing for some of us, but it's the way that we'll find healing. I want to tell you that this meal is for every person who believes in Jesus as their Savior and Lord. You come here today and you say, you know, I feel like a million miles away from God, but I am trusting in Jesus. Celebrate with us. Maybe for the first time you want to trust in Jesus. This is the day of salvation. You say, I want to, for the first time, I'm going to put my faith in Christ as Savior and Lord of my life. And man, do we invite you to take communion today. We celebrate with the angels today. The angels are throwing a party. We want to throw a party for you too. So come to this table. In a moment, our ushers are actually going to bring communion to you. Hold on to it when it comes to you, the bread, the wine, because at a certain point in this song, we're going to celebrate together, eat together, drink together. But listen to the words of this song. It's a new song. We're going to invite you to sing it once you get a chance to know it. I just pray that many of us will just let Jesus in. Let's pray right now. Lord, we know that it's so easy for us to stiff arm you, to not let you in. But in moments like these, Lord, we realize that there's no better thing that we could do than to let the healer take control, to let the miracle worker do his best work. Father, our lives, some of us, well, all of us, we're pretty messed up. But we thank you that it's okay not to be okay. That you're doing something new here this morning in us. And that's what we pray for. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
That Jesus was betrayed and arrested, he sat around the table with his disciples and he broke the bread and he gave thanks. And he said, "This is my body which is broken for you. As often as you eat this, do it in remembrance of me." Let's take and eat together. In the same way, he took the cup and he said, this cup is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. For the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink this, do it in remembrance of me. Let's take the cup together. Jesus, we remember right here in this moment the great cost of our salvation. That this cost you something so great, it cost you your life so that we could have life. And not just any life, but life to the fullest. So God, right here in this moment, as we are about to sing the chorus of this song, that you would make us an offering, make us a vessel for you, God. We want you to have all of the rooms of our hearts right here in this moment, God. May you just sweep through the entire house. Clean us out, God, that we would become the men and the women that you are calling us to be, that you've created us to be. So, Jesus, we look to you and we trust in you. Amen. Would we stand and let's sing that chorus one more time. Well, thank you so much for coming today and joining us as we start a new series, start a new year together. We hope to see you next week as we pick it up in week two. But thanks again so much for coming. Go in His grace and His mercy. And for anybody who's new, we have a welcome reception out in the lobby. Just follow. There's a sign out there. Ask a volunteer if you don't know where it is, but it's right out those doors. We'd love to meet you, meet some of the staff. So we'll see you there. All right. God bless.